Unit 6, resource allocation. There are four articles in this unit, the four articles in the textbook, in fact. They're Paul T. Menzel, Rescuing Lives, Can't We Count? Alvin H. Maas and Mark Siegler, Should Alcoholics Compete Equally for Liver Transplantation? John Harris, The Value of Life, which I think is the most important one of them, and I'll probably spend the most time on. And then Nick Beckstead and Toby Ord, which is the most recent of them, and discusses something called QALY, Quality Assisted Life Year, Quality Adjusted Life Year, which is a unit that is used to attempt to quantify effects of treatments. So we'll talk a little bit about that. Theirs is a little bit wonky, their article, but I think you can probably get the gist, and I'll talk a little bit about it. Okay, so let's take them in order. Menzel's is a very short piece, and essentially it's about, it's arguing against multiple organ transplants. That is, cases like the little girl from Manchester who came to Pittsburgh, Laura Davies, in 1993 to get a transplant of, small and large intestines, stomach, pancreas, liver, and two kidneys, all transplanted. And he argues that this shouldn't have happened. It's not just that she doesn't survive, because other people have had similar treatments and survived, at least until the time of the article. It's that her getting the scarce resource of those various organs all at once means that, suppose we could save someone with the small intestine, someone with the large intestine, someone with the stomach, someone with the pancreas, someone with the liver, and someone with each of the kidneys. We could have saved seven people for instead using the organs on that one person. So he argues that this is just not a good use of resources. Now, of course, that makes him sound kind of like a monster because, you know, at the time, I'm sure, particularly in Manchester, where she's from, Manchester, England, not Manchester, New Hampshire, she was a cause célèbre. She got the money for the surgery by appealing to the public. So all these people chipped in to pay for the operation. And yet here's this author, Menzel, saying she shouldn't have got it. So essentially he's saying she should have died, which sounds brutal. But his argument is that we, in a situation where we have limited resources, we can't afford to pool them all on one person. We should try saving more people with the resources that we have. He asks the question, how can transplant centers justify ultimately letting two or more persons somewhere down the queue likely die because they have drawn so much out of the organ bank to save one, the transplant centers? If the donors who are donating the organs, why would they feel good about having contributed to a net non-life-saving project? That is, this using all of these organs on one person is net non-life-saving. In other words, we could have saved a lot more people with all of these organs. Because, of course, all of these organs came from different people, I assume. Not necessarily, but certainly they could have gone to more than one person. So Menzel's article sort of puts the problem in stark relief that we've got to make a decision about who gets what when the resources are scarce. Now, he's talking about it in the instance of organ transplantation, but of course it equally applies for respirators, as we saw early in the coronavirus pandemic, when New York City in particular, or in Italy and Spain when they were just flooded, the equipment, the masks and gowns for the healthcare workers, which are still in short supply, as far as I know. The N95 masks were being rationed. So that's a rationing, that's a resources issue too. But what we're focusing on here in particular is organs. And that point is taken up in the second article by Moss and Siegler, who asks, should alcoholics compete equally for liver transplantation? So, turns out that a major cause of needing a liver is alcohol abuse. You destroy your liver by constant alcohol abuse over years and years. It's called cirrhosis of the liver. Basically, the liver has to filter all the toxins out of your blood. And when you're forcing so much alcohol through it, it destroys it. So there is this condition called alcohol-related end-stage liver disease, abbreviated as ARESLD, which is the result of this abuse. And a lot of people who need liver transplants, up to 50% from what I can gather here, are people who need them because of this alcoholic abuse. Now, the question is, should they be ranked equally with patients who have conditions, who have problems with their liver, that is not their fault? Like a child with the condition called biliary atresia. Babies born with biliary atresia. So their livers are damaged just for genetic factors. It's not their fault. So the point is that it looks like the alcoholics have destroyed what would have otherwise been a healthy liver through their own actions. And they're competing against people whose livers are damaged through no fault of their own. What should we do with this information? Should we just rank them all equally? Well, Moss and Siegler say no. So Moss and Siegler's proposal is that it is only fair that patients who have not assumed equal responsibility for maintaining their health or for accepting treatments for a chronic disease should not be treated differently. Should be treated differently. Considerations of public values and mores suggest that the public may not support liver transplantation if patients with this condition routinely receive more than half the available donor livers. That's their conclusion. So, but essentially they say alcoholics should at best be ranked much lower. They should get them after everybody who was not an alcoholic has received a liver. So if we can save everybody with just end-stage liver disease that is not alcohol-related, if we can save every one of those, then if there are any livers left over, they can go to the alcoholics. That's their suggestion, essentially. Now, that seems pretty harsh as well. And they consider two criticisms of their position. First is to say that alcoholism is a disease. And if alcoholism is a disease, then how is it different from biliary atresia? If my liver is damaged because of a life of alcoholism, that's just as much not my fault if the alcoholism is not my fault as, somebody who's born with a damaged liver. In both cases, it's not the fault of the patient. So why should the alcoholics be treated differently from the others? That's if alcoholism is a disease. And it's widely considered to be a disease nowadays. And in fact, what's interesting about Moss and Ziegler's approach is that they agree, yes, alcoholism is a disease. However, they then go on to say there are effective treatments. And they draw an analogy with type 1 diabetes. So if you have type 1 diabetes, it used to be the case that you would just die as a child. But now there are effective treatments with insulin, although, of course, one of the scandals about healthcare recently is the price of insulin keeps going up and up, even though the person who figured out how to formulate insulin didn't patent it because he said, I shouldn't be making money out of something that is for saving people's lives. And nonetheless, the drug companies keep jacking up the price so that diabetics are rationing it to fatal results. Anyway, if you are a diabetic and if you're in a country that, you know, provides free insulin, let's say, then you should be held accountable for treating yourself. And if you damage yourself because you didn't follow the treatments, because you were stupid or lazy or something like that, then we can hold you accountable. And they say the same is true with alcoholism. They say, well, on page 392, let me quote them. Even though alcoholism is a chronic disease, alcoholics should be held responsible for seeking and obtaining treatment that could prevent the development of late-stage complications such as ARESLD. Alcoholics are responsible for undertaking a program for recovery that will keep their disease of alcoholism in remission. So they say, even though it's a disease, there is a treatment, and if they stuck to the treatment, as Alcoholics Anonymous says they can, and Alcoholics Anonymous is a little bit controversial. I mean, if you're an atheist, you probably don't like that one of the stages is you have to admit that there's a higher power or something like that. So some people are critical of Alcoholics Anonymous in particular, just because of it's got these trappings of kind of religiosity and things like that. And it's there are other features of it that people question. However, it is unquestionable that a lot of people have maintained sobriety through Alcoholics Anonymous. And there are other treatment programs too, that it's just that's the most famous one. And they and what Moss and Ziegler say is because treatment programs like that exist, and they are available, if you don't take them up, then you are responsible. So even though it's a disease, it's a treatable disease, and you're responsible for treating it. I think there's a response to what Moss and Ziegler say. That is part of the problem with alcoholism as a disease, is that people refuse to acknowledge that they've got a problem. I don't know, I've known people who I'm pretty sure are alcoholics who refused to view themselves as alcoholics. It requires a lot to view yourself as having a problem that you cannot control, as being an addict. And most people do not want to view themselves as addicts whose behavior is not under their control. And in order to get treatment at all, you have to make that first step. And suppose you don't make that first step. And I've known people who are perfectly functioning alcoholics. That is, they hold down a job. They're not drunk at their job. They just come home and drink and drink and drink until they pass out, and then they get up the next day and go to work. I mean, I couldn't do that. I would feel awful all the time, but they seem to have this magic ability. People like that can very fairly say, look, what's the problem? I'm living my life. I do what I need to do. I have a few beers in the evening. And they don't seem to acknowledge just how many beers they have. I saw a joke, a pandemic lockdown joke, which was, it used to be the case that if you had a huge pile of bottles outside your house for the trash, because you're an alcoholic, you would say, oh no, I had a party. Whereas during the lockdown, because you weren't allowed to have parties, everybody would say, oh no, it's because I'm an alcoholic. So what you're ashamed of changes depending on the circumstances. Anyway, that is their position. Moss and Siegler say that, yes, although it is a disease, it is a disease that it is your responsibility to control, and if you don't, we should take you off the transplant lists because your condition is your fault. Now, the other criticism to their view that they consider is that, wait a minute, smokers get medical treatment for lung disease. This reminds me of something that my wife told me about. My wife, when she was in college, age 19, went to study in Germany for a year, and this was before the fall of the Berlin Wall. Yes, we're that old. It was in the late 80s. And while she was there, she visited the then still existing Soviet Union. And a black marketeer sort of attached himself to her. And he smoked like a chimney, despite being, you know, almost her age. She was 19 at the time. And she commented on this, and he said, yeah, but if I get lung cancer, I'll just get new lungs from the state. The state will give me a lung transplant. And she regarded this with horror. I mean, I'm not sure if lungs were that readily available or if the lung transplants were that good in those days, but that was his view. I think a lot of us from outside would say, well, that's not a very good attitude. You're saying that it's okay for you to smoke because you can just get a free replacement pair of lungs. But it is true that lots of people who have damaged their lungs get medical treatment. And similarly, what about people who are obese? Isn't that just like alcoholism? Obesity is something that results from behaviors that you have to admit that you've got a problem before you curb, and most people don't. They just say, I'm a little bit heavy. And it leads to heart disease. Should we say, oh, I'm sorry, I'm not treating your heart disease? That's another thing. This is not an issue that we're going to get into in this class, but it's certainly a bioethical issue. Occasionally, this comes up that politicians sign into law things that enable pharmacists to refuse to give treatments that violate their religious convictions. And this is always things like Plan B, which is, or abortifacients, chemical abortions. Plan B is not a chemical abortion. Abortifacient, it just denies implantation. But some people, particularly devout Catholics, have an objection to that. And I think in Michigan we had an issue where pharmacists were allowed to refuse to fill that prescription because of their religious convictions. It never comes up that people say, I'm not going to give you your heart medicine because obesity is a result of greed, which is one of the seven deadly sins, and your behavior is a violation of my religious convictions. Somehow that never comes up, but I digress. Anyway, the objection to Moss and Siegler is that Moss and Siegler is saying no, alcoholics shouldn't get treatment, and the objection is, but wait a minute, we give treatment to other people whose conditions are as a result of their freely chosen behavior, like people with heart disease because of overeating, or people with type 2 diabetes, which is from bad eating habits, or smokers. And what's Moss and Siegler's response to this? The first one is that one thing is, of course, that the livers are in short supply. And of course, If livers weren't in short supply, then it wouldn't be a problem. Even if we gave the livers to the people with just regular ESLD, there would still be livers left over for the alcoholics. But it's only because there is short supply that these issues of resource allocation come up. So that's one thing. And whereas some of the treatments in these other cases, like treatments for heart disease, there's no short supply of the drugs that are supposed to fight cholesterol or lower your cholesterol level or things like that. And, you know, there's no short supply of stomach stapling surgery. It's not as if there's a limit that, you know, the only limit is whether or not you can afford it or whether or not there are enough doctors prepared to do it. But in case of liver transplantation, there's an actual limited supply of livers. But there are two arguments in response, one moral and the other procedural. The moral one is to do with fairness, and they consider principles of fairness. And the one that they settle on is that according to the principle of what they call formal justice, which is that we should treat like cases alike and only treat cases differently when they are relevantly different, they say, well, the alcohol-related end-stage liver disease patient's condition is relevantly different from the just regular end-stage liver disease patients in that their condition was preventable, could have been prevented. So they can be treated differently. And they said there's another principle, to each according to personal effort, that we should treat people according to their personal effort. The fact that had they put in the effort, then they wouldn't have alcohol-related end-stage liver disease. Now, again, I think these are questionable. First of all, it's not clear to me that this really is an issue of effort. I haven't seen alcoholics say, yeah, I've got a problem, but I just can't put in the work. You know, I can't be bothered. I'm lazy. I don't think that's what alcoholics are about. It's a genuine case of addiction. It's like we don't say to junkies, oh, your problem is that you're lazy. We say that, you know, it's got its grips into it. You don't have the willpower. And I think willpower isn't necessarily a matter of effort. It's something you are born with or you aren't. I think some people are just born with iron willpower and can kick habits, and other people aren't. And also, levels of addiction are different. Some people just have addictive personalities. And some people, the first drink they have, I don't know if you people still watch The Simpsons, but there's one episode I remember where Homer's friend Barney, it shows him before he's an alcoholic. And he's really, you know, a go-getter, and he's a sharp guy. And then it shows him having his first beer, and you can just see it's got its grips on him, and he is sunk. He's just a hopeless alcoholic, and there's nothing he can do about it. And some people, their brains, I think, are just set up to be receptive to certain chemicals. And if they aren't exposed to their chemicals, they're okay. But if they are, they're just going to be addicted to it, and they're going to seek it out. So I'm not sure how much I buy Moss and Siegler's response. They do offer a caveat. They say, because it is unfair to treat differently just for being poor, if a person is too poor to afford treatment, that is, if I don't know if Alcoholics Anonymous costs money. I've never had to find out because I'm not an alcoholic. I could have been. I certainly drank to excess when I was an undergraduate, but I never became one just because of the way my brain is. I'm not an addictive personality. I don't drink much alcohol at all anymore. So I don't know how expensive Alcoholics Anonymous is, or certainly lots of other treatments are expensive. And what they say is if you really put in the effort but you couldn't afford the treatment, then maybe you should have a better chance at a liver. They don't say as the same chance as people with, say, biliary atresia, but a better chance than, you know, say, a rich alcoholic. So that's their first argument in response to the claim that it's unfair to treat alcoholics differently when you don't treat smokers or people with heart disease differently. Their second argument in response is policy consideration based on public support. And they cite a Harrison Associates national survey that says the public gave life-saving therapy for patients with ARESLD the lowest of all priorities. When asked to rank, their support for therapies, what would they pay for, or what do they think that if they had a healthcare system, what should they pay for? A very interesting thing to study, if you're interested in this issue of allocation of resources. It's an issue that national healthcare systems have to deal with, because national healthcare systems fund all the treatment through taxation. If you've got private healthcare systems, then it tends to be basically if you're poor, you don't get treatment, and if you're rich, you get treatment. So it tends to be that, you know, the distribution of treatment is according to who has money. Now, of course, those of us who come from countries with national healthcare systems think that's outrageous, but the problem faced by national healthcare systems is they have to make the decision of who gets what. And this is one thing that was seized on when people were opposing single-payer healthcare systems back in the Clinton era, or back in the early days of Obamacare. You might remember there was a suggestion that there would be death panels. There would be panels that have to decide who lives and who dies. Well, guess what? That's exactly what the issue of resource allocation is about. Menzel, the first guy who argued against the little girl getting the multiple organ transplant, sounds like a death panel because he's saying she doesn't get to live. These are the decisions you have to make. In England, of course, we have a national healthcare system, as does much of Europe. In fact, most developed countries, including Canada, the only glaring exception is the United States. The vast majority have some kind of national healthcare system. And even, of course, the United States has Medicare and has the veterans system. But a state that tried to institute this was Oregon. Oregon tried to institute a system where there was voting on who got what. And of course, you're not just deciding who gets a liver, you're deciding, should we spend money on dialysis machines or should we spend that money on childhood inoculations? You're trying to make comparisons across vastly different treatments, and it's very difficult. So they have to take polls like this Harrison Associates survey to work out what the priorities should be. Where should our public money be going? Should we buy 100 respirators? Should we buy 1,000 respirators? Should we buy 100 respirators and spend some money on dialysis machines and other money on this? Where does the money go? These are the kind of decisions you have to make. Anyway, in ranking their priorities, the life-saving therapy for patients with alcohol-related end-stage liver disease was given the lowest priority. In other words, the public shares the view of Moss and Siegler that, hell no, people who've drunk themselves to a damaged liver don't get a new one. They had a good liver, they blew their chance, they don't get to be treated. They have to die now. That's the public's view. And Moss and Siegler says whether or not that view is right, if you've got a system that relies on public support, and of course the donor system does rely on public support because people have to give their livers, they have to donate their livers. Although, as I noted in my previous lecture, the United Kingdom has just changed the system to an opt-out system, so presumably there should be a lot more organs available in future now in Britain, because It's assumed that you donate your organs unless you say otherwise, rather than the way that it still is in the United States. You have to explicitly say, I'm donating my organs, otherwise they don't get donated. Anyway, there has to be public support. So if the public is opposed to, for good reason or for bad, if they are opposed to people with alcohol-related end-stage liver disease getting livers, then we better not go against their will, because if they find out we are, they're going to stop supporting it. They do say, this is Moss and Siegler, they do say that there are some complications about how we should deal with people with alcoholism. They say on page 395, further research should answer lingering questions about liver transplantation for alcohol-related end-stage liver disease patients. Which characteristics of a patient with alcohol-related end-stage liver disease can predict a successful outcome? In other words, which kind of people are going to respond to treatment like Alcoholics Anonymous? How long is abstinence necessary to qualify for transplantation? You have to be dry, you have to be sober for a certain amount of time, otherwise there's no point in doing the transplantation, and we have to know that someone's going to stick with it before we select a candidate. What type of social support system must a patient have to ensure good results? As you might know, if you've got any addicts in your family, it's no good just, even if they make the decision to go into treatment, it's not going to just do that. You know, you have to make sure that you support them and that you keep them away from the things that draw them back into that life. I mean, you know, if you're an alcoholic, don't go on a tour of Ireland, you know, where there's a pub on every corner, or anywhere in the UK, where drinking culture is in a huge part of the culture. Just don't go there. You know, you want to visit, I don't know, somewhere where there's a prohibition in effect. You need social supports, and if people don't have social supports, they're not going to respond. All right, so that's a fairly interesting discussion about whether or not your behavior should discount you for receiving scarce resources. And I think I understand the knee-jerk response, like to the Russian black marketeer that I was talking about, who just said, you know, I can keep on smoking because I'm going to get free lungs if I damage them. That kind of attitude seems reprehensible. I mean, we shouldn't reward that kind of response. But on the other hand, if alcoholism genuinely is a disease, it really does seem to be an issue of fairness if you say, ah, your fault, you had a good liver, you ruined it. Just as, you know, people with type 2 diabetes, should they not get treatment because they ate badly? I mean, I don't think people don't become alcoholics by choice. People drink alcohol through choice, but I've drunk alcohol and then I stopped. Why? I think because my brain is different from alcoholics, or because I was fortunate enough not to have a horrendous home life that drove me to it. So I think that Moss and Siegler's argument, I don't know, it seems like it deserves challenging. But on the other hand, remember, livers are a very scarce resource. And if it's true that we don't even have enough livers for kids with biliary atresia, then maybe that changes the issue. Maybe because it's so scarce, we can afford to be brutal. All right, now we're getting on to John Harris's article. And this is not focused on specific issues like transplantation, as the first two were. It's, it shares in common with the previous article, the Moss and Siegel article, in that it's discussing reasons for rationing care, or reasons why somebody should be higher or lower on the list of priorities of getting treatment. And here, we're not comparing various treatments. So we're not saying, should a blind person get treatment to cure their sight? Should we spend money on cataract surgery, or should we spend money on dialysis? We're not talking about comparing across conditions, although, of course, that is an issue that you have to think of. What we're talking about is, suppose we have two people with the same condition, and we can only treat one of them. How should we decide? Now, of course, Moss and Siegler say, well, a relevant factor is whether or not their condition is their fault. So if this person's liver is damaged because of alcoholism and this person isn't, then we choose this person because it's not their fault. So they say whether or not your condition is your fault is one factor. Other factors that Harris considers are, what if this person over here is younger? Should we give this person life-saving treatment because they will have more life to live? So in effect, we're getting more bang for our buck by saving this person than this person, because we can save this person, but then they'll just die of natural causes before this other person would. So for saving this person, we get more for our money than we do for this one. That seems like, on the face of it, very reasonable. Harris gives an argument right at the offset to challenge that, and that is the anti-ageist argument. And speaking as someone in his 50s, I approve of this anti-ageist argument. So what he says is this. I'm going to quote him at length, although you're not allowed to do that in your write-ups. All of us who wish to go on living have something that each of us values equally. That is, you, me, a child, each of us has this same thing. And this thing is the rest of our lives. Now, of course, the rest of your life is going to be presumably longer than the rest of my life, I hope, for your sake. But we, each of us, value the rest of our lives in the same way, he says. Whether we are 17 or 70, in perfect health or suffering from a terminal disease, we each have the rest of our lives to lead. Now, so what? Well, there may well be a double injustice in deciding that those whose life expectation is short should not benefit from rescue or resuscitation. In other words, suppose our current practice is, okay, if we have to choose between saving the older person or the younger person, we save the younger person. And what the anti-ageist argument says is that this is a double injustice in saving the younger person. Suppose I am told today that I have terminal cancer with only approximately 6 months or so to live. But I want to live until I die, or at least until I decide that my life is no longer worth living. Suppose I am then involved in an accident. Boy, my life sucks. And because my condition is known, and there are not enough resources to help all who could immediately be saved, I am marked among those who will not be helped. I am then the victim of a double tragedy. I got cancer and then I got in an accident. It seems like you're kicking me when I'm down, when you're saying, I'm already going to die young and you're not even going to give me that. My last year or so was going to be so precious. And now you decide, because I only got a year to live, you're not going to even give me that. That seems to be the double injustice. I am the victim of a double tragedy and a double injustice. The point, this is Harris still, is a simple but powerful one. However short or long my life will be, so long as I want to go on living it, then I suffer a terrible injustice when that life is prematurely cut short. All that was from page 398. And to illustrate, he gives an example of a class full of students. Remember when we had classes full of students? Ah, the good old days. Well, maybe not so good, because their lecture hall catches fire. So you imagine a class of students trapped in a blazing lecture hall, and he asks, should the rescuers shout, youngest first? he says that seems ridiculous. I mean, of course, everybody, stereotypically, they're supposed to have shouted on the Titanic, women and children first. And then, of course, Billy Zane tries to cheat. But nowadays, we wouldn't say that. We would just rescue everybody that we could. We wouldn't say, wait a minute, you go back in, you're a bit too old. So that accords with the anti-ageism argument. We would say that it is crazy to favor people according to their youth in that situation. And so the anti-ageism argument says we shouldn't favor them in healthcare situations. So page 398. The anti-ageist argument denies the relevance of age or life expectancy as a criterion. Absolutely. In other words, you're not allowed to take it into account. And then on page 399, he says, I think the anti-ageist argument has much plausibility. It locates the wrongness of ending an individual's life in the evil of thwarting that person's desire to go on living, and argues that it is profoundly unjust to frustrate that desire merely because some of those who have exactly the same desire, held no more strongly, also have a longer life expectancy than the others. So everybody, whether they're 17 or 70, wants to go on living. This might be surprise some 17-year-olds who think, boy, if I look like you, Mr. 70-year-old, I wouldn't want to go on living. Well, wait till you get there, and then you will. You'll find that, somehow I am no more inclined to go. In fact, old people commit suicide at a much lower rate than young people, as far as I know, which isn't really surprising, because if you've made it to old age, you're probably not the kind of person who's likely to commit suicide. But you don't see old people saying, I can't take this cranky hip and forgetfulness anymore, I'm going to end it all. No. You find things that you enjoy. This ties into the discussion of disability that we saw a couple of units ago, where Ash was arguing that it was a misconception that disabled people's life is constant suffering. Disabled people enjoy their lives just as much as non-disabled people. They have, they're happy with their existence in the same way that people who don't have disabilities are happy. Same with old people. You might not want to be old if you're not old. And, you know, as Danny DeVito in Jumanji, the most recent one, I don't know if it's 2 or 3, says, getting old sucks. But then by the end of the movie, he says, getting old is a gift. It's because it's your life, and you know what to do with it by the time you reach that age. You've figured out a way to get enjoyment out of a more restricted life, and it's your life. It's all you've got. So the anti-ageist argument says everybody values the rest of their life the same. Okay, so that's an argument against factoring in age in deciding who gets treatment. Should we give the life-saving drug to a 10-year-old or a 70-year-old? The anti-ageist argument says you can't pick the 10-year-old just because they're younger. Now, when I put it in those stark terms, I think most people will say, I don't know about that. So he considers another argument, which he calls the fair innings argument. I don't know if that's a phrase. I have lived in America for more than half my life, and I'm still not sure what phrases are distinctively British and what are just universal. I don't know if fair innings is an English term. It comes from cricket. Anybody who dies at about age 90, people will say, well, he had a good innings. You lasted a long time. You had a good shot at life, is what it means. And he's referring to that phrase here. The fair innings argument takes the view that there is some span of years that we consider a reasonable life, a fair innings. That is, if you last that long, you did good. You got your fair share. And he suggests that 70 is a fair innings. As I am now closer to 70 than to 30, I'm not so sure 70 is enough, but we'll let that rest. Anyone who does not reach 70 suffers, on this view, the injustice of being cut off in their prime. Those who, however, do make 70 must consider any additional years as sort of bonus, beyond which you couldn't reasonably hope for. The fair innings argument requires that everybody be given an equal chance to have a fair innings. So notice that the anti-ageism argument says that you can't favor the 10-year-old over the 70-year-old, whereas the fair innings argument says you can, because the 70-year-old has had a fair innings. Now, the fair innings argument says you can't favor the 10-year-old over the 60-year-old, because neither of them has had a fair innings yet. But once you reach that fair innings, then you can't really say, oh, I demand more life and take it away from that 10-year-old. No, you had your shot, is the argument here. So the fair innings argument is supposed to agree with the anti-ageism argument. In other words, in general, you shouldn't take age into account. But when you're allowed to take it into account is when somebody's had a fair innings. Then you can take it into account, and then you can say that that person can't really complain anymore. So it's like the anti-ageism argument for most cases, but it does allow favoring younger people over people who've had a fair shot at life. So the attraction of the fair innings argument is that we can preserve the conclusion of the anti-ageism argument that so long as life is equally valued by the person whose life it is, it should be given an equal chance of preservation. And we can go on taking this view until that person has reached a fair innings. And then we can say, yeah, you've had your shot. We're going to give the resources to someone else. Now, he considers possible objections. One objection is that, well, if you set anything as a fair innings, then any reason you got for picking, say, 70 years, you could use that reason for arguing for a lower quantity. So he says he imagines we're choosing between a 30-year-old and a 40-year-old. Who gets the treatment, the 30-year-old or the 40-year-old? And the 30-year-old argues, well, the age of 40 looks much closer to a fair innings than 30, and that the 30-year-old, should be given a chance to get closer to that fair innings of 40. So why can't we say that the 40-year-old has had a fair innings and I, a 30-year-old, have not, so give the treatment to me? So if any cutoff line means that you can stop, you can say that that person doesn't deserve any more, then the criticism of the fair innings argument by the anti-ageist argument. So this criticism is coming from the anti-ageists. The anti-ageists say, you, the fair innings argument, you want to say I'm basically on your side, but I want to say there's a cutoff. And the anti-ageist says, yes, but if you allow the cutoff anywhere, then that's just going to slide into an argument for allowing age in any circumstance. So that's the criticism. In response to this, Harris said, well, but does that criticism really work? I mean, can you give, just because there is 70 years as a fair innings, can you start arguing that therefore 40 years is closer to a fair innings? Can you do that? And he argues, he gives a suggestion that maybe you can't. So he gives the analogy of a mile race. If it takes 7 minutes to run a mile, then giving people 3 minutes or 4 minutes is equally unfair. You're not being more fair to the 4 minutes person than you are to the 3 minutes. Obviously, this is like 30, 40, and 70. So instead of tens of years, we're talking about minutes to run a mile. He says, so in other words, the 3 minute person can't say that the 4 minute person is getting a fairer running time. That's his attempt at rebutting. I'm not even sure if he's particularly happy with that response, because he says there's still a problem with the fair innings argument. And he says the problem is that while the fair innings argument identifies correctly that it is always a misfortune to die when one wants to go on living, even if you're 90, It is both a misfortune and a tragedy when your life is cut off prematurely. And he suggests, so in other words, a 70-year-old dying is a misfortune, but a 30-year-old dying is a misfortune and a tragedy, because it's not just a misfortune because you don't get the life that you want, it's tragic that you never got a fair innings. So he suggests maybe we should adapt the fair innings slightly. He says, while the phrase old age is irredeemably vague, a reasonable form of the fair innings argument might hold that people who have achieved old age, or who were closely approaching it, would not have their lives further prolonged when this could only be achieved at the cost of those who are not nearing old age. It would be morally defensible to prefer to save the lives of those who still had their lives before them, rather than those who had already lived full lives. The criterion to be employed in each case would simply be what reasonable people would say about whether someone had had a fair innings. Now, this seems very vague, but actually the criterion of what a reasonable person would say is much used in the law. So this is a respectable standard. It's a legal standard. Like, I'm not sure it's used in cases like obscenity, but often it says, you know, it's obscene if a reasonable person would call it obscene. So you're old if a reasonable person would say you're old. Now, does that mean, what if you look young? I've seen 80-year-olds who look like 60-year-olds, and I've seen 60-year-olds who look like 80-year-olds. Does it depend, is it whether a reasonable person would say you have had a full innings, or is it whether a reasonable person, when given your life, would say, oh yes, 58 years is near a full innings, or whatever. But he says, but again, it must be emphasized that the fair innings argument would only operate as a counsel of despair when it was clearly impossible to postpone the deaths of those who wanted to go on living. In all other circumstances, the anti-ageism argument would apply. Now, this is where his argument starts to get challenging or more interesting. There is a further problem for the anti-ageism argument. While living as long as possible is obviously important to people, it's a bad basis for justifying healthcare resource allocation. In other words, we don't believe, when you hit a certain age, say 70, your body starts to break down in a lot of ways. Old people are the ones who take up the majority of doctors' times. If you go to any clinic and look around you, the majority of people are old people, because their bodies start to break down. It's like when you go to, garages, you go to places that fix cars, you don't see new cars, you see old cars. Those are the cars that need fixing, because things start breaking down, you know, that have lasted for a certain amount of time, they all start breaking down at once. So old people in their old age, a lot of things need fixing. Should we devote all of our resources, or the majority of our healthcare resources, to those kind of conditions, the conditions that affect old people? If we take seriously the anti-ageism argument, we should, because those are the majority of conditions of people that go to the doctor. Old age conditions. Teenagers don't go to the doctor much unless it's a real emergency, unless they, you know, got drunk and smashed their car. But otherwise, you know, they're pretty rubbery. They can, you know, they fall down. They don't break their hip. So if we take seriously the anti-ageism argument, it seems like we would skew our healthcare resources wildly towards saving old people, because they're the ones who go wrong. So do we want to do that? That's taking the anti-ageism argument pretty seriously. If we decide that we don't, then we need an alternative for the anti-ageism argument when we're talking about healthcare resources. And you know, whether we should spend more money on old person care or young person care. In deciding between treatments that save a lot of people a short amount of time and those that save a few people a lot of time, we favor the latter, suggesting that we do value extra years more, whereas the anti-ageism argument says that we shouldn't. Okay, so he begins this discussion by saying the anti-ageism argument says, you know, we say we shouldn't give the 30-year-old the treatment over the 60-year-old on the grounds that the 30-year-old has probably got more years to live. We shouldn't value the more years more. But what he says is that our intuition is that we should. If we're choosing between a treatment that gives 1,000 people 1 month extra or a treatment that gives one person 10 years extra, we say that the one person getting 10 years extra is more important because the month doesn't make that much difference. So this seems to go against the anti-ageism argument, because the anti-ageism arguments would say, no, come on, if you're talking about treatment, if you're saving 1,000 people and it's not their fault that they only last 1 month more, you should do that over saving one person. That's obviously the right thing to do. But then he says, one consequence of this new lifetime view, in other words, we should focus on the time saved rather than ignoring it as the anti-ageism view is. So one consequence of this lifetime view is that we should think it more important to save one 10-year-old rather than 5 60-year-olds, which of course is not what the anti-ageism view suggests. But on the other hand, so at that point we seem to be abandoning the anti-ageism argument. But then he says on page 401, it is just at this point that the anti-ageism argument seems to require resuscitation, because there is surely something insidious about sacrificing two 45-year-olds to one 15-year-old. He says, obviously if we say one 10-year-old more than 5 60-year-olds, it seems like okay, because we think the 60-year-olds are so close to the full innings that we want to save the 10-year-old who hasn't had a good shot. But then when we start adjusting it, well, what about one 15-year-old over two 45-year-olds? The 15-year-old, if we go to distance to age 70, has what? 55 years, whereas two 45-year-olds have just, what is it? 50 years. So we should still save the 15-year-old over the two 45-year-olds. But he says that seems wrong. Now our intuitions are saying we should save the two 45-year-olds, which is what the anti-ageism article argument says. So which do we favor, the life years view or the anti-ageism? The other problem with the lifetime view is that now that actually, despite the fact that we introduced it with the idea that, you know, it's years lived that matter, if we just count the years, then the lifetime view is favoring giving the 1,000 people the 1 month treatment over the one person getting 10 years. Because if we add up all those months, I'm not sure, would it make the, yeah, 1,000 people, there's more than 1,000 months in 10 years, isn't there? Yeah. My math is terrible. If we count out the total time saved, if we give 1,000 people 1 month, it adds up to more months lived than the 10 years of one person. So the lifetime view would say we should save the 1,000 people, which of course also doesn't seem intuitively right. So what do we do? The lifetime view seems to commit us to favoring total lifetime saved, just adding up the months. Okay, and at that point, my audio went out. So I recorded a regular length lecture and thought I was finished, posted it to YouTube, and a student pointed out it went, I started sounding like a chipmunk at minute 59. So I'm going to have to redo the rest of it. Where were we? We were talking about the lifetime view, or life years view. This is the view where we just To work out the effectiveness of a treatment, we add up the years total that it gives us. This is a lot like utilitarianism, in that if you remember in utilitarianism, the right action was the one that maximized happiness for all affected. And it didn't care who was getting happy. So in utilitarianism, if I'm choosing between making 100 people very slightly happy, almost so that they don't even notice the difference, versus making one person incredibly happy, I should actually choose the many people, because even though they're only being raised a tiny amount, when you add up all of their happiness, it totals to more than the happiness the one person experiences. Same with the life years view, as we've just been talking about. If I give 1,000 people an extra month, even though they barely notice it, that's more than giving one person 10 more years, just because it adds up to more. So that's one problem with the life years view. On the other side, it seems to, Harris gives the example of, imagine if we could invent an immortality elixir, but only a dosage enough for one person. Seems like the life years view would say we have to do it, because if we make one person immortal, they're literally going to live forever, so they have infinite life years, and that's going to be more than any other amount. So even if the alternative is giving everybody on Earth a lifespan of up to 80 years, that's still only a finite number, even if though it's enormous, so it's still going to be less than the one person having immortality. So that just seems to be wrong. Now, the other problem that he points out with the life years view is that seems to follow from its impersonality. It doesn't care who gets the years. He says there's something weird about it because, well, I'll just quote him. This is on page 403 and 404. As long as those who die are replaced on a one-for-one or better than one-for-one basis, that is, for every person who dies, we get at least one new person born, there will be no loss of life years, nor will there be any gain in life years when particular individuals live for longer. For if the overall world population is stable, then prolonging the life of particular individuals does not increase the total number of life years the world contains. That's on page 403. So looking at sort of this vast sum total of life years in the world just seems to be somehow missing the point. Because if at some point, if you're caring about life years, you're not really focused on particular individuals and the particular effect of your treatment. And he goes on, we do not, then, have always to calculate the probable net savings in lifetime of any particular policy or therapy before knowing what to do, and can revert to the more customary consideration of the number of lives that might be saved or lost. But we still have the problem that the anti-ageism view might seem to favor, if we go back to the case of adding 1 month on to 1,000 people and then giving 10 years to one person, we still have the problem that the anti-ageism view might seem to favor that as well. So why is it that we think that that would be kind of pointless, that it would be better to give the one person 10 years than to give 1,000 people a month? And the answer is because, he says, because those months aren't worth the same as months in a regular life because, well, as he said, he draws an analogy between, imagine you're about to be executed and then you're told, okay, you're not going to be executed tomorrow, we're going to give you one more month. He says that month wouldn't be worth much for two reasons. One, as he puts it, the prospect of imminent death discolors existence and leaves it joyless. And it's an almost necessary condition for valuing it is its open-endedness. In other words, you don't know when it's going to end. And I think we can agree in that everybody, whenever it's sort of a feature of various stories or sci-fi novels, imagining if you could be told the date you're going to die, you wouldn't want to know that. And if you knew that, it would make the rest of your life miserable. Nobody would want to know. This is why people with Huntington's disease avoid learning if they've got it or not. You know, there's a test, and a lot of people with Huntington's don't want to know. So what that tells us is that small amounts of time should be discounted unless they're part of a longer span given to one person. Okay, so where does that leave us? Well, remember that he started discussing the anti-ageism view and the fair innings argument, and then said, but maybe these aren't appropriate for healthcare treatment. So it seemed like a more appropriate measure for healthcare resource decisions would be the life years view. But he decided that the life years view had all of these counterintuitive implications, and that therefore we should go back to the anti-ageism view for healthcare. Now, this is an important point because the life years view is actually very like the QALY standard of Beckstead and Ord that we're about to talk about. So a lot of Harris's arguments against the life years view will apply to Beckstead and Ord's view. So Beckstead and Ord and Harris are sort of arguing on opposite sides. Harris argues for an anti-ageism view, an actually anti-discriminatory view, anti-disabilityism view as well. I'll say a bit about that in a second. So that's Harris's view, and against a sort of measuring sum total of all the time saved. And Beckstead and Ord do the opposite. They say people criticize our QALY standard because of some anti-discrimination view like Harris's, but really that's not going to get you anywhere, so we need to go with their QALY standard. So I'm just going to read one more quote from Harris. He says, each person's desire to stay alive should be regarded as of the same importance, irrespective of the quality of their life or its expected duration. This is on page 404. Now that's important. Notice he says the quality of its life or its expected duration. The expected duration is the ageism part, but the quality of their life, he says that shouldn't matter either. So in other words, if you're choosing to give a treatment to a blind person or a sighted person, you shouldn't say we should give it to the sighted person because their life will be better. You know, a year of sighted life will be better than a year of blind life. So he is opposed to that. So that's his anti-disability argument. And he also argues for anti-ageism because he says the expected duration of one person's life shouldn't count. So if we're choosing between a 15-year-old and a 60-year-old, we shouldn't say give it to the 15-year-old because they'll live longer. Now, one qualifier. The quote goes on. This would hold good in all cases in which we have to choose between lives except one. And that is where one individual has had a fair innings and the other not. So in other words, if you're choosing between a 15-year-old and a 60-year-old, you can't say favor the 15-year-old. But if you're choosing between a 15-year-old and a 70-year-old, if we decide that 70 is a fair innings, then you can give it to the 15-year-old because the 70-year-old has had their fair shot. And anything more would be bonus, whereas the 15-year-old, their death would be a tragedy rather than just what was the language he used? It would be a misfortune. That's right. Anybody's death is a misfortune, but somebody who dies before they reach a fair innings is also a tragedy. Okay, so that's Harris. Let's look at Beckstead and Ord's article, which is the bubbles under the wallpaper article. Now they're talking about the QALY standard, which stands for Quality Adjusted Life Year. And what this essentially worked this out by working out years of life that a treatment will add to somebody's life times the quality of their life. Now, what I think is controversial about this is the quality of life measure. But basically the way this standard was worked out by healthcare economists, because if we want to work on a big scale and work out where should we pour our money in, what kind of treatment should we pour our money into, we need some kind of measure to choose between them. Should we spend it on childhood vaccinations, or should we spend it on kidney machines, dialysis machines? And they say the way you should work it out is Well, in a simple way, look at a person and imagine they're not going to get the treatment. Work out how many years they're going to live and how many and the quality of their life, and multiply those two together. Then think of that same person with the treatment, and then work out how many years they're going to live and the quality of those years. And then you subtract the quality measure for without the treatment from the quality measure with the treatment, and that's the effect of the treatment, that number. And then you work out how much money did that cost us, and then you look at another treatment, work out the quality that you get from that, and then and divide it by the amount it costs. And then we can work out which treatment gives us the best bang for our buck. And this is what healthcare economists use, according to Beckstead and Ord. Now, how do we work out the quality of life? Well, this is the important question. It goes from 0 to 1, where 0 is death, where your quality of life is 0, you have no life, to 1, which is full health. And they specifically give the example, if you're blind, your quality of life is 0.5. And this is where I think someone like Ash, if you remember her reading from the reproduction chapter, I think she would disagree. She says, I think she would ask, according to whom? Who came up with this 0.5? So in other words, the quality of life of a blind person is half the quality of life of a similar sighted person, assuming they have no other problems. Where do you come up with that? Did you ask a blind person, someone who's blind from birth? Did you ask Stevie Wonder? You know, is the quality of your life half somebody else? I bet not. So, that's where I think there's a hidden controversy that Beckstead and Ord just gloss over. And I'll come back to that in a second. But you get the basic idea. So it's very much like the life years view. In other words, we work out some total of added years and they add in the quality. And that's the way we should judge whether or not a treatment is effective. And they say, well, people criticize this, as Harris has. And the way they put criticism like Harris's, and they specifically cite him on page 406 and 7, they said, since a healthy person gains more qualities from having their life extended than does a person with a disability, other things being equal, we should save the life of a healthy person over that of a disabled person. That's the implication of the quality view, that someone like Harris would say, hang on, that's prejudice. That's a double injustice, because you're saying the person that already suffers from being blind, and then we're going to compound that suffering by not giving them treatment because their life is worth less. You know, it's like, apply that to racism. We say, well, you know, minorities in this country have a shorter standard of life, and because they're poor, they don't enjoy their life so much. So we're going to spend more money on the white people because, you know, they get more out of life and they're likely to live longer. That, you can see the double injustice there quite obviously. Shouldn't we be spending more on the people who are suffering already rather than the people who have already got it good? Beckstead and Ord's response to this criticism is essentially to say, well, every standard is going to have problems. And we'll show you. And they give this case. So let's look at the case of Alice and Beth. So Alice and Beth, where's the little table? There we go. Alice and Beth. So the choice is between Alice and Beth both have a disease. It won't focus. I'm sorry. Alice and Beth both have a disease. Alice has it slightly more severely, but otherwise they're identical. They're both 20 years old and in normal health. And we can give them two treatments. We can either treat either one or the other. If we give the treatment to Alice, she will live 45 years, but she will go blind. If we give the treatment to Beth, she has two possible options, 60 years blind or 35 years in full health. Okay, whom should, now, then they say, we've got to avoid problems. We've got to try and decide who gets what, and we've got to avoid these problems. The first problem we should avoid is preference for smaller benefits. That's what the qualies, if you're committed to the quali standard, you say anything other than the quali standard will be giving lower benefits. And it's just silly to do that. So violating the first problem would go against Beckstead and Ord's standard. We've also got to respect people's choice. So if somebody chooses one option rather than another, we shouldn't force them to have the other one just because we think it's better. We should respect their choice. So we must avoid problem two, pointless violations of autonomy. We should avoid problem three, disability discrimination, which we've just looked at. And in fact, yes, let's look at that. Now, what happens if we prefer option X over option Y? Well, option X is Alice gets 45 years blind and Beth gets 60 years blind. If we prefer giving Alice 45 years, then this is a preference for smaller benefits, obviously, because they're both blind and one gets 45 years and the other one gets 60 years. That's silly. So we shouldn't prefer X over Y. All right, what about preferring Y over Z? Well, Y and Z are both options for Beth. And as it turns out, if you ask Beth which option she wants full health. She doesn't, even though it's almost half, it's just over half the number of years, it's 35 years rather than 60, she would still prefer to have 35 years full health rather than 60 years blind. So if we prefer the 60 years blind, we are violating her choice. So which is problem two. So we shouldn't do that. We shouldn't prefer Y over Z. What about Z preferring Z over X? Well, Z is 35 years full health for Beth, and X is 45 years blind for Alice. Well, if we prefer Z, we are preferring 35 years over 45 years just because Beth is in full health. Well, that commits disability discrimination. So we shouldn't do that. So we shouldn't prefer Z over X. So we've ruled out X over Y, Y over Z, and Z over X. So in other words, we should prefer Y over X, Z over Y, and then X over Z. But if you realize what we've done, we've said Y is better than X, Z is better than Y, but X is better than Z, which gets us in a circle. It's a paradox. It's a failure of transitivity. Transitivity is where if one is larger than two and three is larger, I'm sorry, if two is larger than one and three is larger than two, then three has to be larger than one. And that fails because we've said Y is better than X, Z is better than Y, but X is better than Z. So which do you choose? Which is the best? Each of them is better than one of the others, but worse than the other one. So it seems like we're stuck. We can't decide which one is best. So that means that we have cyclic preferences. We have no way to choose. That's the fourth problem, which is on page 408. So what do we do? Well, they give a suggestion. Now, obviously, the quali standard just avoids number one. It says it has a preference for larger benefits, and it doesn't care about the other three. It doesn't care about pointless violations of autonomy, and actually it wouldn't have cyclic preferences if you just stick to the quali. So the only problem with the quali standard is it might pointlessly violate autonomy or have disability discrimination. The only problem. Well, all right, what about an alternative to that? Well, they suggest, what about something called a rights-based approach? On page 408, they give this summary. On this approach, when we have equally expensive treatments but can save only one person's life, the person who stands to gain the most life years, ignoring any quality adjustments. Okay, so the rights-based approach is sort of like Harris's in that it says we shouldn't look at quality. It's not quite like Harris's, because Harris says we shouldn't look at quantity either, and this is still going to care about the quantity of years, but it's going to take away the quality of life part. So it's not going to say that being blind is worse than being sighted. All right. So on this approach, when we have equally expensive treatments but can save only one person's life, the person who stands to gain the most life years, ignoring any quality adjustments, is awarded the right to treatment. But that's stage one. So, in other words, if we apply that to Alice and Beth, we look at Alice, she gets 45 years blind, and we look at Beth, she gets 60 years blind. Okay, Beth gets the right. Does that mean we give her option Y, because that's the 60 years blind? Well, not yet, because the second part of the rights-based approach is the person may then select the treatment that she most prefers to receive under the advisement of her doctor. So, stage one, we choose Beth because of option Y, because option Y gives her 60 years blind to Alice's 45 years blind. But stage two is Beth says, okay, you've given me the right to have treatment, but I'm not going to choose option Y. I'm going to choose option Z because that's the one I prefer. So if we use this approach and we're choosing between all three, the choice we get is option Z. We choose Beth and she chooses option Z. All right, but so the rights-based approach still has the cyclic preferences problem. Because if we're comparing pairwise again, if we're choosing between Y and X, we choose option Y, obviously, because Beth gets more years. If we're choosing between Z and Y, we choose option Z. Now, why? Because option Z, we're supposed to ignore quality and Z is 35 years, and Alice gets 45 years. But remember, there are two options. Now, actually, this is a slight problem. We would only choose option Z if option Y was available. If option Y was not available, then we would choose option X. But finally, if we're choosing between X and Z, we choose X because Z over Y. Yes. When we're choosing between Z and Y, we choose option Z. So scratch what I said. Let's start again. If we're choosing between Y and X, we choose Y because Beth gets more life years. 60 years blind, 45. If we're choosing between Y and Z, they're both Beth, and we go with what Beth wants, and Beth wants option Z, so we choose option Z. Now, if we're choosing between Z and X, we do choose option X, because we don't care about blind versus full health, and option X gives us 45 years, and option Z gives us 35 years. All right, so we end up choosing Y over X, Z over Y, and then X over Z. So we have the same cyclical problem. There's also an extra problem with the rights-based approach, which is the violation of independence of irrelevant alternatives. That is, if you have these three options, you're always going to choose either X or Z. You're never going to choose Y because Beth doesn't want Y. But if Y is available, that means you choose Z. But if Y is not available, that means you choose X. Let me explain that in detail. Imagine the doctor is using the rights-based approach to choose between X, Y, and Z. Because of option Y, 60 years over Alice's 45, Beth gets to choose, and she chooses Z. So Z wins if you have all three. But just as the doctor is about to administer treatment Z, the vial containing treatment Y rolls off the table and breaks. So now the doctor says, wait a minute, Y isn't an option. I've got to choose between X and Z. And because the rights-based approach says quality doesn't matter when choosing between who gets it, Alice's 45 years in option X is better than Beth's 35 years in option Z. So now when he was going to do option Z when Y was available, now because Y is no longer available, he has to choose option X. Notice that Y isn't chosen in either case. So why should this third option that nobody's going to choose, why should it affect whether or not we get X and Y? This is the independence, you should have, your choice should be independent of irrelevant alternatives. And Y is an irrelevant alternative. And notice, suppose we're choosing between X and Y, and we don't know if Y can be obtained somewhere in the world. Maybe we can get Y. Ooh, if we better get on the phone, see if Y is available somewhere in Australia, and we could get Y. Because if we could get Y, then we have to choose Z. Notice that the availability of Y is not so that we can give Y, it's so that we can give Z. And this just seems crazy. So it's a weird kind of irrationality. And that's what's wrong with the rights-based approach. So the rights-based approach has this kind of craziness that makes choosing the treatment just crazy difficult. Then they consider, what about a random lottery system that, you know, we just put people in a lottery, like with the like with kidney transplants. There's a list, and you're chosen randomly from the list. Actually, I'm not sure that's true. You're placed at a certain point on the list, and you will move your way up. But imagine we did a system where we just choose randomly. Like there used to be with green cards. There was a green card lottery. People in different parts of the world could enter to get a green card, and they drew a lottery, and that was one way to get a green card. The Trump administration killed that. And, you know, some people said it wasn't fair because more people from Ireland got into the lottery in the first place, so they were weighted. And there, Beckstead and Ord's criticism of a lottery says that essentially it doesn't solve the problem, because you don't have problem one, preference for smaller benefits, because you're choosing randomly. You have a version of that, which is people with smaller benefits have exactly the same chance as people with better benefits. So that, you know, if you're choosing between 45, the person who gets 45 years blind has the same chance of getting the treatment as someone who is 60 years blind. And that's a problem too. So even if you do it randomly, you get a version of each of the problems. So their summary is, we have shown that it is impossible for a moral theory to provide guidance in multi-person trade-offs between length of life and quality of life without facing one of four very challenging conclusions. Those are the four problems, the main four: preference for smaller benefits, pointless violation of autonomy, disability discrimination, and cyclic preferences. So they say, let's go with qualies. And after all, they say qualies get all these criticism, but only because they're the only well thought out alternative. The thing about qualies is everything's clear. They've laid everything on the table, and you know what they're going to suggest. So when you know what they're going to suggest, people can say, oh, I don't like that. And people can come up with all sorts of criticisms. Where if you suggest another alternative that isn't as clearly and well thought out, you don't know what implications it's going to have. You don't know which people it's going to choose. So it's kind of insulated from criticism, because you can't say, the soon as the system shows what it's going to choose, people can criticize it. But if it doesn't show what it's going to choose, you know, it's harder to criticize. It's the reason why politicians are very vague about their policies before they get elected, because they know if they clarify exactly what their policy will mean, yes, it's going to mean that you people get less money, then immediately those people are going to hate it. So politicians are very cagey about admitting what their policies do for exactly this reason. Whereas the quali says, you know what we're going to say, so you've got all these criticisms, but any other system would have worse. It's just we don't know what they were going to say. That is Beckstead and Ord's conclusion. And it's a very clever argument. It's basically their defense of the quali system is like a famous comment by Winston Churchill. Now, Winston Churchill was a very famous figure in British politics, and for some reason he's well known over here, probably because he was the Prime Minister during World War II. And he was a very witty guy, and he was a great writer. I think he won the Nobel Prize for Literature. Trump has compared himself to, or at least Trump's fans have compared him to Winston Churchill. apart from the fact that he's never been in any wars, and Winston Churchill was famously brave and reckless, I don't think Trump is going to win the Nobel Prize for Literature anytime soon. But Churchill said things like, you know, he was at dinner and a woman who didn't like him said, "Winston, if you were my husband, I would give you poison." And Churchill immediately snapped back, "Madam, if you were my wife, I would drink it." So he's a clever guy. And he famously said of democracy that it was the worst political system except for all the others. So basically he's saying it's the least of all. Of course, democracy has problems, but it's the lesser of all the evils. And essentially, Becksted and Ord are going to say, sure, our system has problems. It's going to be prejudiced against blind people. Sorry. What's your alternative? Ours is the least worst option, is what they're going to say. And of course, Harris is going to say that's not true, because it values the wrong kind of things. And remember that built into Becksted and Ord's system is this quality system where you've got to judge the life of a blind person. Now, maybe you could fix the quality system by just changing the ranking. So instead of saying a blind person's life is worth 0.5, say a blind person's life is worth the same as a sighted person, if a blind person's happiness is the same. And studies on happiness have shown that if something terrible happens to you, your happiness plummets, but by a year later, it's back up to where it was. Even if that something was going blind or being paralyzed, it seems like we recover. And that I think people are more willing to say that a blind existence is half as good as a sighted existence. The people who say that are the people who can't imagine being blind. But if you ask blind people, they have found ways to live their life. They've found new things that they didn't enjoy as much before. Maybe they listen to radio a lot more. Maybe, you know, their other senses are heightened or whatever. Or they found, whereas before they were kind of aimlessly drifting around, now they found a purpose in their life. Like, for example, I had a former student who, this is the craziest thing, a friend of his asked him to look after his pigeons. I think they were pigeons. And Mike looked after the pigeons, and he got some kind of disease from them that made him go progressively blind, so that in a few years he was effectively blind. He could see light and dark, but he wasn't allowed to drive, and he had to use a stick and stuff. And you think, I would be so mad that, you know, I was doing someone a favor and this happened to me. He's the happiest guy. He got a law degree. He runs a practice that specializes in disability law. Just the greatest guy, and doesn't seem mad at life in the slightest. So I think this quality of life, obviously, I think it makes sense for somebody with horribly extreme arthritis or rheumatism, like Lillian Boyes in the Singer book, who was just in constant agony unless she was sedated, unless she was given morphine. That person's quality of life is very low. But something like being blind, I don't know. All right, I'm going to stop there.